Hey, gang, ready for some more dub talk? Just make sure that when you're watching, you leave the lights on in the room. And don't sit too close to the computer screen. Also, watch out for spoilers and bad language. And remember that everyone's opinions are different and aren't the same as the rest of the Dub Talk Guild. So now that that's over, let's get this started. Because I've got a fire in my belly and I'm ready to go. Fire Dragon!
Hello, one and all, and welcome to Dub Talk, the show where a group of friends get together, drink, burn down a city, and perform magic while talking about the latest and greatest in anime dubs. Tonight, I am your host, Megan, and with me I have... Hi, Elf Hardy?
Hello!
Wait, there's no elves in this fucking show.
How does this work?
Fuck it, I want to read you. God damn! Just introduce yourselves, fuck off!
I'm Spaceman Hardy. I am a...
What?
My specialty is beer magic.
You sure you're not Kana?
I might be, I don't know. Or Bacchus.
We can only aspire to be on the level of Kana. True facts. Who the fuck are you?
Who the fuck am I? You don't know who the fuck I am?
Well, I said introduce yourselves because my brain is mash.
I didn't hear that part. Hi, my name is Stephanie. I don't know what my magic power is.
Your magic power is being a mom.
I don't think that qualifies as a magic power.
Yes, it is.
No, it doesn't, because I'm not actually a mom.
I guess your magic power is dancing?
We'll go with it. I'm taking dance classes, ladies and gentlemen. That's why it's relevant. Anyway.
And my name is Megan, and my specialty is trash magic.
Nice.
If you haven't guessed, tonight we are talking about the one, the only, the family. Guys, let's have our obligatory fairy tale episode.
Oh boy.
Here we go.
We had our obligatory One Piece one last year.
Haven't had our obligatory Naruto episode yet.
True, or Bleach.
Hardy gets to host the obligatory Bleach episode.
What? Don't you put that evil upon me, woman.
Don't you bring that evil into this house, Ricky Bobby.
We've had the obligatory My Hero episode.
Well, we already had a regular My Hero episode. I'm not allowed to be on the My Hero movie episode. Somebody else who wasn't on the episode has to be.
The first
Bleach movie is good, Hardy. Fight me. If you can't tell by the bewilderment, tonight we are here to talk about Fairy Tail, but what part of Fairy Tail are we talking about? It's like, what, 200-something episodes at this
point?
We're
not covering the whole fucking show.
We're not covering the show. Instead, we're gonna talk about train wreck part of Fairy Tail that is called Fairy Tail Dragon Cry.
I don't think it's a complete train wreck.
Fine, it's a fan service train wreck.
It's a fan service train wreck. I will agree with that.
Anyway, so, just for a disclaimer, this is not part of Summer at the Movies. We're putting this up as the episode that goes up the week that we are at Anime Fest in Dallas, Texas. Hooray!
Yes, so now you all know we will be at Anime Fest. That's sort of an announcement. Fest.
Well, we're going to make an announcement, like, probably for that Monday, but...
But I'll say, one, we've been hinting at it for a while. Two, we probably announced it Monday. But,
So, by this point in the day, when the episode is up, we will be barbecuing, swimming, and probably making Andrew cry.
True facts.
And I'm going to be making Gigi watch episode 2 of Mad Wolf 34.
And Hardy is going to want to punch me in the face afterwards. I have a story for Hardy that's going to get me hit in the face. Also, we're showing all the boys various clips of Udapri because you will not believe it until
yes.
you see it.
Some of the things of Udapri make me scratch my head and I don't understand, but I'm like, fuck it.
Anyway, Stephanie, because I am too lazy, I didn't buy this. Stephanie let me use her Funimation digital copy to watch it.
Yep, I have.
Please give us a synopsis of what this movie is about.
Sure, but side note, the main reason why we're covering the movie is...
Oh, I forgot to say that. Oh, right.
because last year when we went to Anime Fest, somebody in this episode mm-hmm. may or may not have pulled a little wool over the girl's eyes with the help of some of the other guys.
I mean, that's not quite it. Wednesday night
when
we got
there, bitch.
To A-Fest.
Bitch, let me use my magic to tell a story, you whore.
Well, you're telling it wrong. The main reason is we wanted to go see the
film. I'm getting there. Anyway.
And I ruined it.
Funimation. Anyway, Stephanie ruined it. Funimation was throwing a special showing of it at the Alamo Drafthouse. Last year, all of us who went to A-Fest, which include the three of us, went there, and it was actually one of the first things we ever did as a group in person.
Yep.
After I almost punched Hardy in the face at check-in.
And then after we almost punched somebody else at the theater.
Oh yeah, and then Noah showed up too and screamed about Puppet Toon cartoons. Those are his favorite type of cartoons.
Yeah, if you saw the A-Fest vlog from last year, you will remember that Hardy appeared out of nowhere when we were checking into the hotel. And then following that, when we went to go see Fairy Tail Dragon Cry at Alamo, Noah popped it out of nowhere.
We also learned that the people who made the highway in Texas made it on the phrase, hold my beer and watch. So Steph, please explain the plot of this movie.
So if you haven't heard or seen A Fairy Tail Dragon Cry, this particular film, in the Kingdom of Fiore lies a terrible weapon. Enter the Dragon Cry, a magical staff rumored to possess power capable of destroying the world. For years, it's been safely guarded and kept away from those tempted by its power. But everything changes when a traitor named Zash manages to steal it away. Now in the hands of Animus, the cruel ruler of the Kingdom of Stella, a plot begins to form with the fate of the world at their mercy. Luckily, a simple recovery task is nothing for the Wizards of Fairy Tale. Together, Natsu and his friends will go undercover to infiltrate Stella Kingdom in hopes of getting answers and restoring safety to the realm. But they'll quickly find there's more to this staff than the stories claim. What power really dwells within the Dragon Cry, and is the gang strong enough to fight ultimate destruction?
And by espionage, I mean Natsu just punches things and sets it on fire, gray strips, and there's a lot of fan service.
So it's...
No, you're not 100% accurate, because Natsu did try being a ninja at one point and failed horribly.
Hardy, you were saying?
No, I was basically saying it's fairy tale in general, as per usual.
Just so. Now with more budget and less censorship. Anyway, so let's get started with the director and writer. Luckily, there's only one person who handles all of Fairy Tale at Funimation. Okay, sometimes two, but that other person isn't here. So for the director and the writer of this film, it is Tyler Walker. He does not have his little buddy Kyle Phillips with him. Not for this time. So Tyler Walker, as a director, has also directed all of the Fairy Tail anime, Luck and Logic, and 91 Days. As a writer, he did write some of Fairy Tail Samurai Warriors, and he did the scripts for Ace Attorney. So your thoughts on the direction and writing? You can also use this time, if you've seen the Fairy Tail dub, to maybe comment about it as a whole, because honestly, guys, this is the only time we're going to talk about the dub of Fairy Tail.
More than likely, it's going to be the only time we'll talk
about Fairy Tail. That's not 100% accurate. You have to remember, we covered Fairy Tail Zero
true.
A few years
this
back.
This is the last time.
Yeah.
True facts. We'll say the original time, the original story, the original
time. In the present day, in the present time, in this present place. Is that what that's from?
Lane at some point. Jesus.
I've never seen Lane.
Present day, present time.
I've never seen Lane.
We need to fix that.
Hardy, go ahead, because you're usually the one who goes first with all this. Also, I think you're the only one of the three of us who's actually watched the entire anime.
That is true. Yes. That is true. And so on that subject, I will just basically Fairy Tail in general. Has been known to have one of the stronger dubs of the long-running shonen types, unlike some of them, such as Yu Yu Hakusho or Dragon Ball Z, which had certain strong performances, but also several weaker ones. Fairy Tail, I find, is a bit more consistently good. It's not perfect by any means, but, I mean, then again, no dub is. And I think for this particular film, everything seems very well put together and directed. I don't really have any negative things to say about it outside of a few performances. But in general, as far as the dub is concerned, it's pretty good.
So as someone, in terms of fairy tale, because for people who may or may not remember, last year, much of the group was trying to accomplish the hashtag year of fairy tale situation. I got as far as Grand Magic Games.
You got to the beginning of it. I got to the end of it.
I got the start of Grand Magic Games, and then I just too much shit, and I got so far behind I couldn't do it anymore. But so I at least have an understanding, at least, of the tone and the feel of the show itself. And with Dragon Cry, how it was directed and scripted, it doesn't feel like it's a full-length film to me. It just feels like it's an extension of the show. Like, it's just a couple of regular episodes put together to make a runtime of a film. So the feel and the tone of it, I can appreciate that it's still consistent with the show itself, and it doesn't deviate or take any liberties just because it's a film and it has a film's budget rather than a TV series. So I can appreciate that a lot. And like Hardy was saying, it's not a perfect show, not a perfect dub by any stretch of by any means. But something that Fairy Tail does have present, I feel, is a lot of heart to it. This is a show where there's a lot of sincerity and a lot of heart to it. Sometimes it's really dumb and does stupid things on occasion, but with it having so much heart with it, you can really get invested with the show very easily, and there were points where I really got invested in the show, and in the movie too, in this case. So to keep that consistency between the show and this film and make it feel like it's not even a film to me, I really appreciate that. And because Tyler Walker, he is amazing as a director. I mean, because Ms. Megan said he directed 91 Days, yes, but he also directed Bakano back in the day. So he's a very, very strong director. So trusting him with the franchise in general, I think, was a very, very good move on his part. Because a lot of the performances are distinct. A lot of the writing is consistent. It does get you to chuckle here and there. Some people might have more laughs than others, depending on what's going on and your enjoyment of the franchise, I should say, in general. But the film also gets a few laughs out of you too. But in general, in terms of the directing and writing of the film, I like that it still stays consistent with the tone of the show, and it doesn't deviate from that same tone just because it's a film. You know right. What I mean? Yeah. So I do like the directing and writing on the film.
Oh boy. I have a very love-hate relationship with Fairy Tail. There are arcs of it that I absolutely adore, like, oh god, I'm forgetting. Is it Edelus is the one where they go to the world? Yeah. Yeah.
Like, Edelus, yeah.
Edelus is like the best part of the show. It could have ended like right after that and I would have been fucking fine. Like, there is stuff I really love, like the Edelus arc. There is stuff I absolutely hate, which would be the introduction to Wendy arc. Fuck that shit. And also that one episode of Grand Magic Games, which is literally all of the girls posing in an arena, including the 5-year-old. Fuck that shit. That being said, Fairy Tail is a dub that when I started it, it's a show that really has a lot of what are now either the introductions for a lot of people to certain actors, or it's what cemented them
mm-hmm.
as a star. And sometimes don't necessarily like a lot of those performances at points, because it might just be the show, because Fairy Tail walks a very frustrating line with me that is either absolutely sincere and absolutely balls to the wall crazy and enjoyable, or absolutely degrading and frustrating, especially if you don't like the way that the girls are written in Fairy Tail, like me. That's my biggest issue with the show. That being said, Tyler Walker does a really good job directing and writing it, and across the board, a lot of his casting choices are very creative and very, they're almost iconic to his style now, and it's a style that he's also passed on to Kyle Phillips, who was his protege, basically, and his assistant Fairy Tail for a long, long time. If I'm correct, it is kind of the fault of Kyle Phillips and Tyler Walker and Kyle Phillips that we have, for example, Dawn Bennett as a Funimation regular. Because I believe Frosch was her first role. I do feel like the movie is really, in, like Steph said, an extension of what makes the dub for the show really good. I do like a lot of the actors that they pulled in as resources and the way that they are used, but also frustrated that they, unfortunately, because of, like, season 3 is coming out sometime after, I think October of this year, right?
I believe so, yeah. It's coming out this fall.
The final season. I know what the happens final season, the, the end of the manga, because I was like, alright, I just want to see how this ends so I don't have to go back and watch the anime. I'm sad that because of the way that simuldubs work, that they potentially can't be in the simuldub of the final season, because it's Fairy Tail, and with every new arc, there's like 10,000 like one-off characters that just get added. I will say that I think if I watched the sub of this movie, I wouldn't have enjoyed it as much as I did watching the dub. There's a lot of really fun writing things in it, including the term Graydar.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, boy.
I love it.
But there's just a lot of...
That's great.
Like, it also be this god. When did the first anime dub end? Like, a couple years ago?
Oh god, because the second one that followed Grand Magic Games was I want to say it was 2014, 15 maybe.
Like the, I mean the show itself, like it's been a couple years.
No, I'm just saying that when that second series, quote unquote, started.
Well, no, the second series literally picks up. It's like, "Oh, hey, by the way, the first anime ended at Grand Magic Games. Surprise, we're back." But no, even if these actors had been away from the characters for the returning cast, it felt like they just walked back into the character themselves. So it's a good solid dub of a movie of a solid dub for the show. That being said, are we ready to move on?
Yes, please.
Yes.
Cool. So we're gonna move on to our first group of characters, which are movie only characters, and I believe they are the three stars of the Stella Kingdom, because Stella means star, guys.
Oh wow!
Woo!
By the way, Fiore means flower. It's the flower. They literally live in the Flower Kingdom. And on your left, the Mushroom Kingdom. It's me, Mario. Oh, fire magic. Also, be their plumbers or magic, and may or may not be dragon slayers. Just saying. So group one is the.
I've got the fire in my belly.
Luigi just keeps stripping down and using ice magic.
Done. Okay.
It's a stiff.
Stop looking at the Maya cannoli.
We just keep making it worse. So the three stars include Gapri, who may as well be evil Sonic the Hedgehog, Doll, a big muscly man who likes his plushies, and Leg Day, I mean Swan. The quote-unquote leg wizard, who, honest to God, is actually the most attractive female character in Fairy Tail. Please step on me. I literally leaned over to Hardy after the movie. I was like, holy shit, Swan is hot. And you remember that.
Were you sitting next? I thought you were sitting next to Noah.
Oh, yeah. In Noah's defense, Noah was asleep next to me the whole movie. And he fully admits
shows
that.
How invested he was in the
Well,
show.
To be fair, he had driven 16 hours to get there, so he needed a nap.
Fair.
No, but Swan, who is quote unquote the leg wizard, and essentially gets to have a fan service battle against Urza. So playing Gapri is Nathan Sharp, playing Doll is Bob Carter, and playing Swan is Christina V. Nathan Sharp, besides being known as Nate Wants to Battle on YouTube for his fabulous music, is also Yoshichika Suguri in Luck and Logic, Marcel in Attack on Titan, and, oh fucking Christ almighty Japanese names, Miyakawa in The Disastrous Life of Psyche K, Bob Carter you'll know as Nabu in Gaire Zero, Over Justice in Space Patrol Luluko, and just for Hardy, Yashia Ape in Baki the Grappler.
Oh, nice.
And Christina V, you will know as Shizuka Hattori in Strike, which is the movie, Ishiguro in Mob Psycho 100, and Velvet Crow in Tales of Cisteria the Cross. So, this is probably going to be one of the quicker sections.
Mm-hmm.
Probably. Cardi, go ahead.
Well, basically, they barely say anything, to be perfectly honest. So,
yeah,
we're going to go through this real quick. As far as Nathan Sharp is concerned, I haven't heard this kind of voice come out from him before. I thought at first it might have been, sounded a bit more like Damon Mills, but had that sort of like graspiness to his voice, like a little rapscallion kind of guy. But it sounded fine.
Rapscallion the Hedgehog.
Yeah, and the three lines that he says, he sounded perfectly fine. And then you have Bob Carter's JoJo villain. tell me he doesn't...
Let me show you my stash.
He is a fucking JoJo's villain.
He's a fucking JoJo's villain. And I can say that because I'm finally watching Stardust Crusaders.
Ah, we found the missing lost pillar men. The Goo Goo Doll.
No, he's one of the tarot cards. He's one of the stand users.
And his job basically consists of calling out the names of his two dolls, who I forgot what their names are.
Like Francois and
I
something.
I think it was Francois.
Yeah. But,
By the way, can we just talk about the fact that Juvia, like, gets Yandere over two fucking dolls?
We're gonna get back to that, but, because I want to talk about that. But yeah, and all three cases, I think he didn't really get much to do because that was he has like three lines, and then Christina V kind of got to go a little bit hammy with her role and just sort of laugh and go semi psycho. But in general, I mean, there's really not much to talk about because they really don't say much. So I think they all did fine for what they had to work with, but. Yeah, that's pretty much it.
Yeah, I kind of have to agree with that. They are really nice additions to the fairy tale story and the fairy tale lore. But because they are essentially underutilized, we see more with our next set of characters, honestly.
Well, characters after that because we switched it around. Remember?
You're right. Forgot. But they... Essentially, the main purpose of these three characters is to serve as some kind of foil for the characters to go through with, I think Wendy and Carlo went against Gopri, Gray and Juvia faced Dolan, and Urza was fighting Swan. So, that's really what these characters are there for. However, that doesn't mean you can't be lazy with the performances, and I really enjoy all these three of these performances. Christina, I did think kind of hammed it up a little bit as Swan. It was a lot of fun to hear that. As for Nathan Sharp and Bob Carter, I actually haven't really heard either of these two really at all, if anything, or recognized them outright. Especially Nathan Sharp. I'm like, holy shit, dude. Nathan Sharp, I know you said it reminds you of Damon Mills, but the character Gopri reminds me of, like, a much more troublemaker kind of Natsu.
He's Natsu with the tan.
Yes, pretty much. It's true because look at the character design and it put Natsu's character design next to him. It comes pretty goddamn close. But yeah, I really enjoyed Nathan Sharp as Gopri and Bob Carter as Doll. I am interested to see if Nathan Sharp will pop in anywhere else in terms of English dubs and stuff, because I really would like to hear him in more stuff. But in general, yeah, I did enjoy these three performances. They were a wonderful addition to the story. It's just that, unfortunately, due to runtime, they don't have a major impact.
Yeah, I'll agree with them. I'll be quick about Nathan Sharp. He was fine as angry little Sonic the Hedgehog, rolling around at the speed of sound, fighting Wendy and Carla. Bob Carter, I'm a little bit more familiar with. By the way, Steph, please just fucking watch Space Patrol Bulico. It will take you, like, 3 hours. Or no, like an hour and a half.
I own it too, which is the saddest.
It'll take you like an hour and a half to watch the show.
See, I started the Japanese. I never got to finish it, but now I do own it, so I need to watch it.
So, he was good as the missing JoJo's character Goo Goo Dolls. I'll be here all night. But Christina V, holy hell, she was a lot of fun. Like, she was clearly having a lot of fun kind of doing this very one-off character who might as well serve to be every straight guy and lesbian girl's fantasy dream battle.
Kind of, yes.
between a girl who can change her outfits all the time and legs for days.
You're not wrong.
You got a point there.
I mean, as the bisexual in this group, I walked out of that theater pleased with half of them.
Oh, we know. You were very vocal about it.
I mean, I'm just saying, I have a thing for women who can kick my ass. Sorry, hon. Oh, wait, my boyfriend knows this. He knows that I...
I'm about to say, Roots knows
this,
right?
Yeah, Roots knows that I have, like,
Roots was there!
That's right, he was there. And I was gonna say no, though, in real life, he knows that, like, my two biggest female anime crushes, like, my two biggest anime crushes in women are Akira Mado and Bishamon from Noragami.
Yep.
Anyway, so, Wizard Leg Urbosa here was pretty fine. And Christina V had a great time. I do kind of feel bad that, like, these guys kind of got relegated to this movie because I feel like Christina V would be a ton of fun, like, as somebody in the new season. But obviously she's out in California and so is Nathan and not in Texas, so I don't know how hard that would be to have them, but they were both really good, and like Steph said, even if you are kind of, like, these very short-lived characters for a movie, you still have to bring it. Otherwise, it does kind of bring down the movie at, like, the intensity. Anyway, are we ready to move on to group two?
Absolutely.
Yeah. We swapped two and
yeah,
three.
Yeah, we swapped two and three
right?
around because when I put this list together, I thought this next group of characters did more than they actually did.
Unfortunately, they don't.
However, they might as well be the actual best characters in all of Fairy Tail, so.
And you're not.
You're not wrong.
You're not just saying that because you have a huge crush on one of them.
Shut your mouth. We all know that. Okay, no. Everybody in the comments can fight me.
Who doesn't love the fucking emo angry dragon
and his,
slayer?
And his librarian girlfriend.
First of all, one, the emo angry dragon slayer is rogue, and I also love him.
Okay, I meant in the terms of this film here.
I'm surprised that he could read.
He's just the angry slayer. Dragon slayer.
I mean, that's also Sting and Loxus, but whatever. So we have Levi McGarden, Gazio Red Fox, and Panther Lily, a.k.a. the actual best characters in Fairy Tail, and at least when you come to Levi and Gazio, the actual best romance in Fairy Tail. Fight me hard.
I ain't fighting you because you're...
I'm not going to fight you. You'll throw an alligator at me.
Levi X Gazio is the best romance in Fairy Tail. Fight me, Nalu shippers.
Levi Gaggio, my OTP.
And Panther Lily is the second best X-seed. Only behind one other character in this movie. Yes. Also, because you brought up the angriest dragon slayer, okay, I'm not gonna lie that my favorite Fairy Tail video of all time is just clips of Sting synced up to Achievement Hunter rage quit clips.
Oh my god, someone showed me that one time. That was the greatest thing.
You gotta climb across whatever the fuck this thing is. Anyway, playing Levi is Christy Kang. Playing Gaggio, it's David Wald. And playing Panther Lily, it's Rick Keeling. Christy Kang you'll know as Yuzuki Fuwa in Assassination Classroom, Ayaka Kaminine in Surrey Duray Children, and Perry in Luck and Logic. David Wald, our favorite DILF, fun police, dad of the century, low-hanging fruit, is Herman Luis in Garo the Animation, Tsurumi and Golden Kamui, and the best Peepami and Pop Team Epic.
I've become evil.
Let's pop together. Whoa, whoa.
Cool runnings.
Cool runnings. Panther. Damn it, you just made me call Rick Keeling Panther Lily. Rick Keeling.
Side note, Alejandro Saab and David Wald. Best Popco Peepami team, fuck you, fight me.
Rick Keeling is Gradadio in Enride, Isaac Weissmel in Phantom, Requiem for the Phantom, and Yukata Yoshino in Joker Game. So feel free to give your thoughts on Christy, Dave, and Rick, not only in this, but in Fairy Tail as a whole.
Okay, first of all, I think Gaggio is just David Wald at his absolute most David Waldness. That is just like every single trope that you can associate with David Wald as an actor is perfectly perfectly identified with Gajiel as a character. So I mean, he's played it to the point to where it's like it's iconic for him. Like, I don't think when I think of David Wald's career, Gajiel, I think, is the character that I associate with him almost instantly. So
I think the same can be said for a lot of
I mean, because
except for the girls, for some dumb reason,
right?
Except for the girls have other roles.
He's just in Oliver Trash.
But anyways, yeah, I really like David Wald as Gajiel. I wish he got to do more in this movie.
I know.
Well, I mean, it's the best. At least he got to do more than Levy. Levy didn't even get to cast a spell.
Poor Levy gets fucked over by a majority of fairy tale.
Yeah. I mean, I'm almost surprised that they even brought them in, because they don't do much and we never find out what the job they took was. So
I feel like
job is a cover for banging each other's brains out.
I feel like they were brought in because I'm pretty sure that Gajiel Levy is a fan favorite.
I think it's mainly because
pairing, if anything.
Because yeah, those three are like a big fan favorite, and so they brought him into the film.
Right.
But yeah, I really enjoyed David Wald as Gajiel. For the other two, I have a confession to make. I've never really been the biggest fan of Christy Kang.
Really?
I was just, something about her has always kind of felt a bit flat. But I will say this, I do like the sort of energy that she gives Levy. Sort of makes her very delightful and cheery and just cute as a character. So she's got the energy going for her. And Rick Keeling has always kind of sounded like he was reading from the page for me, for Panther Lily. Panther Lily is very matter of fact. He doesn't really joke a lot. He just gets to the point. And while that could, some actors are able to pull that off and not sound like they're reading specifically from the page, that's one thing I have never gotten from Rick Keeling, to be perfectly honest. I think he needs a bit more passion in the role. But yeah, that's just for this movie and for Fairy Tale in general. So.
Okay. I'm going to start with Panther Lily too. Because I have to kind of disagree, because I actually really like Rick Keeling as Panther Lily. Like, he is like X-Seed number two, but behind other X-Seed we'll get to eventually. Which I already know who you're talking about, because I have that plushie.
Mm-hmm.
So I think he's a lot of fun, and considering, like, going into the actual show, a little bit, his interactions with Happy and Carla specifically, it makes for a well-rounded balance between the three to me. To be fair, the three of them don't interact together in the film, but typically, like, you can tell if the three of them are together, you know which one is which. Like, you know who Happy is, you know who Carla is, you know who Panther Lily is. And even with Panther Lily, if he's with just, like, Gajiel, or in this case, Gajiel and Levy, you know which one Panther Lily is. You know, you don't even have to look at the damn screen. Especially if you're very familiar with the franchise in general. Which is a credit to the show itself, which with all these very distinct voices, and you know exactly who can be who at any point in time. Which the same can actually be said about Christy as Levy, where she, compared to some of the other female voices in the franchise and in this film, I feel like she has a bit of a warm, like, bookwormy kind of intelligent tone to her voice, where if you were to put her against Lucy, you know which one is which. She has a bit of a low, she sounds similar to Lucy, however she has a lower tone than Lucy does, so you can pick that up, that difference. And of course, if you put Levy next to Erza, stark contrast in personality, obviously. But I really enjoy Christy as Levy, and Levy is actually probably one of my favorite characters of the franchise in general. And then, speaking of favorite characters in the franchise, I love Gaggio. He's such a goober. Such a goober. And the reason... one of the big reasons why he's such a goober and I love this character is because of David Wald. I have to agree with Hardy that if you were to think, if you were to put David Wald's name out there, the first thing that people would probably associate him with is with Gaggio. This is probably the most well-known role he's had ever. And like Megan was saying, the girls would think otherwise, but I mean, you're not wrong. But Gaggio is also very fun. He's this gruff, like, tough guy who will kick your ass. He doesn't give a shit. He'll kick your ass, but he also has a lot of heart to him. And he also has some fun comedic moments, too. And I'm glad they did this in the goddamn movie. The part where him, Levy, and Panther Lily are in the bar.
Oh, God, yes!
And they're eating. Because one of the biggest comedic like running gags in Fairy Tail for Gaggio is the fact that he can play guitar and he tries to sing
badly.
Badly, it just pops in out of nowhere, just trying to get attention by playing his guitar and singing badly. And they did it in this movie, and I am so proud of that.
It's like, sir, you're not a worker here, are you?
It's like, please get him off the stage. Boo this man.
He needs to go. But it was so much fun. Oh. Like, Gaggio is one of my favorite characters in the franchise, and David Wald is a very strong reason for that. So, all three of these performances I honestly really enjoyed a lot. Obviously, the standout is Gaggio because fucking reasons. But, I enjoy all three of these.
See his black steel, if you know what I'm saying.
No, I'm good, fam. I'm
damn
good.
It, that joke flew over your head.
No, it didn't fly over my head. I'm just telling you. No,
damn it.
I don't.
Damn it, my sex jokes aren't working on her anymore. Meh. Oh, no, so...
I have grown accustomed to it.
Not if I get out the scarves, you're not. Anyway, so...
I'm gonna punch you?
I have a new MO. No, so I'll be, I'll go with Levy and Panther Lily first. I agree with Steph on... a lot of things about them, but I will also agree with Hardy that when I was first watching the show, I wasn't really used to Christy Kang as an actress. I haven't watched a lot of stuff that she's actually really prominent in, and her voice...
Same, actually, so I can say that too.
And her voice is very distinct among the female cast. Actually, all of the girls in Fairy Tail, like, the guild, have very distinct voices.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Which... is really sad because that doesn't really translate over to a lot of the other guilds' girls. They all sound very similar at times. And at first, it was very jarring and a little bit grating, but I think as Levy grew as a character, Christy's performance through her grew. And it's just a shame that she doesn't get to do any of the cool Levy shit that she does in this.
Mm-hmm.
Panther Lily, I want him to take me in his strong masculine kitty arms and carry me.
You have a furry crush.
I do not have a furry crush on Panther Lily.
You clearly, basically, obviously confessed to
no,
it.
No, I'm just saying it'd be really cool if he carried me around. He's not the hottest furry character there is.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Yeah.
If anybody with animal features is carrying me around, it's Kogi from Toganrampo. Big foxy grandpa can take me in his masculine arms.
Okay, there we go. Fair.
Anyway, no, I really like him. I just enjoy that he is kind of like this big gruff dude. And I also do enjoy that in the show, I think it's during the Tenro Island, you find out that he's scared of thunder.
Yes,
and I just enjoy that he sounds like a really, really big dude. Like, he sounds like a big buff dude who you would not fuck with. Like, if this guy came, if the voice of Panther Lily came up behind you and told you not to litter, you would clench your balls.
You would actually,
you'd clench
yes.
and cover, and it comes out of the tiniest package. And that's really cool, because compared to the other two, all the other X-Seeds, actually, excluding Freed, who is Laxus's X-Seed, fight me, I'm not wrong.
No.
I mean,
he's Lax's exceed. Just get over it. All of the other exceeds have very cutie, childy voices. Panther right. Lily is a man.
He's a goddamn.
Panther Lily
man.
Is a goddamn man who drinks his coffee black.
The second closest might be the Chris Guerrero Edelus.
Okay, we don't talk about Nichia. We don't talk about Ichia. This is a Nichia and Ichia free zone for the night. Do not bring that evil into
Megan.
The house, Ricky Bobby.
Megan. Man.
Get out of here! Get your fucking hell out of here!
You're welcome, boys and girls.
Never do that again. Never do that again in my presence. Now I know at Anime Fest, I'm going to be like...
You better clench your balls.
I'm going to be asleep at Anime Fest, and Hardy's just going to come up to me, like, over the side, and just from my ear, I'm going to hear it, and I'm going to deck him.
Now you have to do it, Hardy. You should lick you or not.
I don't know. Some of us might want some black coffee while we wake up, so...
Yeah.
True.
But man, no, I really do want to talk about David Waldescagio, because I never thought I was going to like this character, ever.
I mean, the first thing he does
is crucify
Levi to a tree, so.
Yeah.
And her team.
Right.
Like, yes. Gagio is a big villain for the very, I believe the second arc is.
It's one of the first major arcs that he's a big villain.
He spends a lot of time atoning for his actions, and he's actually, I'm not kidding when I say this, that Godzilla is the best developed character in all of Fairy Tail.
You're not wrong at all.
David Wald gets to grow as this character, I think, more than any other actor in the show gets to grow as a character, without bullshit plot devices. Urza et Natsu. Oh god, something caught in my throat. And... David Wald, it is an iconic performance for him. Like, I know for Steph, I think Dr. Ozaki is probably going to always take that spot for her.
Oh, abso-fucking-lutely it is.
I don't think... I think it's going to be Herman Luis is always going to be the thing I, immediately gravitate towards you. Because that was the first thing that I found David Wald in that I super fucking liked him in.
That's the same thing with me and, Ozaki from Shigi, because that was my first real exposure to David Wald as an actor, and I never even touched Fairy Tail before.
But yeah, no, so it's so weird for somebody like the two of us coming into this where we know him for something else and he gets to play this character who isn't what we typically associate with him, especially for the Ladies Night group of Dub Talk, where literally David Wald is in all of our fucking trash. All of it. But I'm really sad that he doesn't get to do more in this movie, and, of all the, fan favorite characters outside of, Team Natsu that get added in, why couldn't he and Levi get more screen time than the other one? But no, I genuinely like the performance, and I was happy they kind of threw him a little bit of a bone, but yeah. So, are we ready to move on to group three?
Yes.
Yeah. Oh boy, more villains.
Yeah, villains and movie-only characters. So this group is basically all of the people who are in the movie, only in the movie. And then after this, it's going to be everybody who's been in the show. It's basically, we're going to start going through Team Natsu stuff. So there is Animus, the King of Stella, who may or may not even be a real person. There is Sonya, who is Animus's servant and who he is intent on protecting, and her magic is being able to sense other people. And then there is Zash Kane.
Then there's this asshole.
This asshole.
Zash Kane.
Where do we start with him?
Zash Kane has a sex dungeon.
Pretty much.
Zash Kane has a sex dungeon.
Kidnaps girls.
Kidnaps women for bad demon blood magic, causes people to fight each other, has a sex dungeon,
rides on a giant red cat.
Did we mention the sex dungeon? I think all of us in the theater,
we all just kind of looked at each other what the fuck? We all just collectively just kind of sighed at each other is this actually happening? This is a franchise that appeals to, like, teenagers. And then there's Lucy getting ready to, like, be, like... He, like, traipses that thing. That knife lingers on her vagina. Like, right over her crotch. It's so, like... What the fuck, Mashima? What the fuck, dude? Playing Animus is Michael Stinker Nicholas. Playing Sonia is Erica Mendez. And playing the master of the sex dungeon, I can't believe it's Ray fucking Chase.
I call bullshit.
Yeah, we're getting there. Michael Stinker Nicholas, you'll know as Dagger in Black Butler Book of Circus, Sobe in Samurai 7, and Taki Tachibana in Your Name. Erica Mendez, you'll know as Avril Bradley in Gosick. Cracker Griffin in Gundam. Oh my god, I have to get this right. Cracker Griffin in Mobile Suit Gundam Iron-Blooded Orphans, and she is also young Luke in Garo Vanishing Line. Ray Chase is Mozugus in Berserk 2016. Tenki Iwafune in K, Return of the Kings, and Sharkan in Magi. So, Hardy, talk about Animus Sonia and Mr. Sex Dungeon.
Well, I have to say that out of these three, they had probably my favorite performances in the entire film. Because in all three of them, they all had to play drastically different characters at different parts of the movie. When Sonia has her big reveal, she basically has to have an argument with herself. And I think, Erica Mendez, we've talked about numerous times on this show, and just how amazing of a range that she has. To go from sweet and innocent Sonia into this very low, almost devilish register when she has her scene, it's really impressive. And Michael Stinker Nicholas, too, to where he has to... I didn't know it was him. Usually I am very, very, very good about picking him out. This time, even when he was just voicing Animus' normal voice, I couldn't tell it was him. But then when he... Yeah. Then when they had to put him under all the distortion, when Animus, you know, has his big reveal and his transformation, that... did not sound like Michael Stinker Nicholas at all to me. That was like completely different. I was like, wow. And then we get to Ray Chase.
And then there's this asshole.
How the man...
Oh, God.
Ray Chase is 30 years old. He is younger than I am. How he is able to consistently pull off the voice of someone in their, well into their 40s, I do not know.
And older at times.
I don't know how to do it, because he...
And who's also probably a chain smoker.
Yeah, and because he did this, and then if you've ever watched Be the Beginning, he plays another older guy and the older guy's father.
I keep forgetting I need to watch Be the Beginning.
Yeah, it's just, he's got a monstrous range. Talk about...
He also plays an older a guy like well into his 40s or 50s, and March Comes in Like a Lion too.
Right, so I don't know how he's able to do it, but it is very impressive. And I do hope we get to review Be the Beginning, because I really want to talk about him there too. So yeah, these were my...
I'm sorry,
it's fine. It's fine. No, but yeah, I just, these are probably my three favorite performances in the entire film, easily.
I can fully agree with that, because despite these being one-shot characters and film and movie-only characters, there is so much complexity to these performances, and you just enjoy them so, so much. Like, Erica Mendez, she has both the compassion for the people of Stella as Sonia, because her big running thing is she's... sees and hears the souls of these people crying out. They want this to stop. They don't want to fight. They don't want to die. And she's very, very compassionate towards her people. But on the opposite hand, you get, like Hardy was saying, basically an argument with herself. Because the key part with when he says that is, spoilers, Animus is actually a dragon that lives inside of Sonia.
That's a hell of a thing to have inside you. It's like, what do you have inside you? Oh, I just ate a lot of food. I'm pregnant. There's a dragon.
I have a dragon. What?
And don't ask me how it got there.
Don't ask me. It's a long story.
Well, it's better than the eels that swim up your
feet. Kinda.
God.
Thank you, Nash and Tara. The hippo is a majestic creature. It won't swim up your dick. Please watch What the Fuck Is Wrong With You. It's so good.
Oh, God. Anyway, having Erica, to an extent, I mean, arguing with herself is a good way to put it, but I think how I see it, she basically has to do a pull a split personality disorder. Because she's both Sonya, and then she also has to be Animus. And I loved it. It was such a great scene. And when she wasn't fighting with her other self, she's very gentle and very compassionate, and I do enjoy Erica a lot. And I will also agree, in terms of Michael Center Nicholas, that you can almost not recognize him at all. Like, in one of the few fucking times we get to talk about Michael Center Nicholas, I don't want to say this is the first time we're actually talking to him as an actor and not a director. I don't want to say that because I feel like...
We've reviewed Your Name.
Yeah.
Right. I am so brain dead. Jesus. I need to go to bed. But, I am right. One of the few times we get to talk about him as an actor. And because I'm familiar with his range... This is nothing. This is not Michael Cinder Nicholas. This is one of those times where one of these times I call bullshit. And it's so interesting and fascinating because he's not only near unrecognizable to me, because I could pick up twinges of it here and there in his tone and inflection that it was him. But considering Animus as a character, both as his human version and then as the dragon, it's full of, he's very troubled, rather dark, and there's a lot of hatred there, hatred which Erica Mendes has to play off of when she goes through her split personality bit, but Michael is just, I love it, it's fantastic, and you barely recognize him in the role, it's great. Like, if I had remembered this when we saw the film last time, I probably would have put it as voice acting Black Magic. For the year last year, but I completely forgot about it. And then the big thing that I really want to call bullshit on, this is not fucking Rick Chase.
I'm also sorry if you just heard a hellacious screeching noise. Shinya finally came out and I freed her of her trap.
No, this is, I'm calling bullshit. This is not Rick Chase. I'm used to Rick Chase in Arohana. I'm used to, what other fucking things have I seen Rick Chase in lately? I'm not used to a gruff, scummy piece of shit. I am not used to an asshole named Zash Kane. And
I was
going to
say,
Yukiatsu
is kind of a grubby piece of shit.
But not to the same tone as this character. Completely different. Like, Yukiatsu is a grubby piece of shit, but he's just a stupid, angsty teenager too, right? Mm-hmm. Zash is just an irredeemable piece of shit. Like, at least in Anohana, Yukiatsu is redeemable, by the end. Zash is not. by any means at all. He's so unredeemable, and he's probably the gruffest tone, not only in the film, but the gruffest and lower bass register that I've ever heard Ray Chase play. And oh my god... He's so convincing as this very terrible human being, and it's just, I don't want this man anywhere near me. I don't want Zash anywhere near me. Like, I don't want to get locked up in the goddamn dungeon. Fuck that noise. I ain't gonna be part of your stupid demon bloodletting ritual bullshit. I am not
the
playing
scary
that
thing.
Game.
The scary thing, Stephanie, is that if he uses his magic, you won't have a choice.
Yeah. Fuck that
That's
noise.
That's the most terrifying thought. I'll have to make sure I have sunglasses from now on, because clearly that's the one way.
No, sunglasses, my only weakness.
That was badass as fuck, is when she just, Lucy just summons Capricorn, gets her badass equip, puts on the sunglasses, and then punches him in the face.
That was the most satisfying thing.
Finally, Lucy does something that's useful.
Like, after everything Zash has done, because he's, again, irredeemable piece of shit, that was so satisfying.
That was literally, like, the first thing that Lucy had done all movie that was useful. It took, like, almost an hour.
Yeah, aside from being a damsel in distress 50 fucking times.
And letting us see her ass crack.
Yeah. But, yeah, it's... Ray Chase is probably my favorite performance of the entire film, because I got so into this character, and I hated this character so much. And I also want to punch him in the fucking face. it's so good. So good. I loved it. I loved all three performances, but this is the standout.
I'll agree definitely on Michael Sticker Nicholas. I'm not as familiar with his voice, unfortunately. Like, I feel like a bunch of anime that he's been in has just either been stuff that I just don't tend to watch or I maybe missed.
Did you ever watch Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles in, like, early 2000s?
No. Did you ever watch The Venture Brothers?
Okay.
No.
Damn it. Because he's done main, like...
You want to know what the big thing that I would remember Michael Stinker Nicholas in? Hitalia.
Who was he in
He's
Italia?
The Netherlands.
Oh.
And I used to cosplay Belgium, so there's that.
Forgot
so, no,
that.
He was really great as not only the animus that is... kind of this illusionary human in everyone's mind between Sonya and, like, what the show wants you to see. Because the show does the movie does a really good job about hiding that twist with, Sonya animus being inside Sonya.
Oh my. Sorry.
Oh my god, he-
Not like that,
you pervert. Oh god, that dragon was so big, he filled me up so much.
Why did you just go there?
Because it's Andrew's birthday and somebody has to be horny on main.
God damn it! Side note, we're recording the episode on Andrew's birthday. Happy birthday, you motherfucker!
Happy birthday, you dirty whore.
Great to see you at A-Fest there, bud.
Like, we should just have this playing on background while, like, while we're at the house.
Can we?
Please, while we're like, swimming and, like, cooking and shit. To me, God, I kind of wish the movie would have mostly focused on the animus and Sonya twist and, like, that shit, because that was honestly, like, really cool as fuck! And, like, the idea that Zash probably knew the whole time, but the animators made it look like he was still looking at animus for all of those scenes, like, that was cool as hell. And Michael Stigl Nicholas plays animus as just, like, there is something very old and chilling about him, despite him being, honestly, very Bashonen.
Yeah.
And Dragon Animus, too, I actually thought they just got a different actor. I didn't know it was still him.
Obviously, there's, like, a lot of...
Yeah, but even then, like, it felt like they got another person.
Exactly.
Noctis and his sex dungeon.
God damn it.
Cruising around in my automobile. Do 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 do. Hypnotizing girls so I can hypnotizing girls and putting them in my sex dungeon. Do 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 do. No, Ray Chase was slimy, awful, and terrifying, and I hated him. And I hated Zash Kane, and I walked out of the theater calling bullshit that was Ray Chase again. Because I had literally just seen him at a con 2 weeks before! And he is not he's a very young guy. A very good-looking young guy. And Zash Kane, I want to destroy. And he's creepy and terrifying and hammy as hell. Like, Ray Chase chews every scene that Zash Kane is in. There is absolutely zero subtlety to Zash Kane.
No, not even a little.
There is no subtlety to this character. Like, the introduction to Zash Kane is about as unsubtle a way to start a movie as humanly possible. In that he mind controls a bunch, he flicks up a cigar in the air, mind controls a bunch of people to kill each other, and it goes, "Come on, that was fun! Mamma mia, look at my cigar!"
Now the kingdom of Faerie is dead.
Oh, god damn.
I slayed a bunch of away to tigers.
He's evil Mario.
He's Wario. There we go. He's Wario.
Wario is evil, but Wario is not sex dungeon evil. Nor is Waluigi. Get it right. We all know Bowser has the sex dungeon.
True facts, but Bowser doesn't have the mustache, so.
I mean, he can get one if he wanted. Just kill a bunch of Goombas and string them together.
Oh my god.
Tonight on Dub Talk, we talk about the ways to make Goomba into fashion.
God
but
damn
no,
it.
Ray Chase was great. But man, to me, my actual favorite performance of the movie is Erica Mendez as Sonya. Because she plays the very soft, sweet, naive, like, little girl Sonya. And then the plot twist happens. And she gets, like, kind of sexy evil Sonya. Like,
kind of
Animus is like, I've been locked in this body for years. Let's get it on. Not like that, in that he wants...
Except not in the sex way.
But, like, there's just this like, power just oozes out of every, like, word that she says, and it's just really fucking cool. And it's really nice when you can tell that a different personality is inhabiting a body, and it's still the same actor, and it's one of the things that really, like... Another really big example for me, and it's probably why it's one of my favorite performances from this actor, is it's why I like Micah Solisod as Black and Blank in Blood Blockade Battlefront. And they didn't have an actor play. And one of the things I really want to appreciate about Tyler Walker as a director is that they didn't. Erica Mendez can do male voices. Erica Mendez plays boys. Like,
right, she does.
Animus would have been a little bit too older, because she usually tends to play, like, younger boys. But they could have gotten an actor who could have played a teenage boy pretty convincingly and had them play both Animus and Sonya. Like, they actually just did that in Blood Blockade Battlefront in the Japanese, in that Black, White, and Blank are all just played by Rei Kugimiya. Or Kugiyama.
Mm.
So I appreciate that Fairy Tail Dragon Cry didn't do that, and it made the twist a lot easier to hide. Because, like, I've seen the movie, like, once, guys, and it blindsided me then, and it blindsided me even though I knew what happened. So, and I think Erica Mendez's performance really plays into that, and the direction on her and just her using her tools as an actress helped really well and brought this character to life. Because, honestly, like I said, the entire movie could literally just be about, like, Zash, Animus, and Sonya and have nothing else for Fairy Tail. Like, none of the other Fairy Tail characters could be in it, and this movie would be fucking awesome. So, are we good to move on?
Yes, yes, we're kind of running a bit long.
We kind of are running a bit long, and we still have three fucking groups.
Yeah, well, we're about to do a duo. It's time for everyone's favorite adorable member of Fairy Tail, Wendy Marvel and her ex-seed, Carla.
Oh shit, hold on. I gotta grab Carla. Carla!
Panther Lily's laying around here somewhere. So.
I don't have one because we haven't found me a Frosh plushie yet.
Yeah.
Because that's the thing, is I get Frosh because...
Sorry, I had to go grab my Carla.
Hardy gets Panther Lily because Hardy's a man. Gajiel's my favorite Dragon Slayer, but my other favorite actual character in the show is Rogue. So, and Garrett Storm's playing him is awesome, and it's actually one of the two characters that turned me around on him as an actor.
Carla.
Anyway, so play Wendy Marvel, everyone's favorite, I believe Wind Dragon Slayer, right?
Right.
Wind yes. Dragon Slayer is Brittany Karbowski, and her ex-seed Carla is played by bitchy Mary Poppins, I mean Jade Saxton. Okay, look, Jade herself described Carla as bitchy Mary Poppins.
This is also true.
Brittany Karbowski, you will know as Asahi Hinagiri in Alice in Zoroku, Kaguya Yamai in Data Live 2, and Luluko in Space Patrol Luluko. Jade Saxton, you'll know as Motome Mayonaka in Akiba's Trip the Animation, Alfried in The Heroic Legend of Arslan, and Akita Toshiro in Token Rambu Hanamaru. Hardy, go ahead.
Sure. I'm going to be rather brief on this. Wendy is basically just... an amalgam of almost every little girl that Brittany has ever played. And that's not a bad thing, because she plays it very well. And this is just not just here in the movie, but also in the show in general. Wendy has always been very sweet and gentle and just... I think she's basically become the heart of the Fairy Tale Guild, pretty much. And
yet you all meme her to fucking hell and back.
Ravioli, ravioli, don't loot the Dragon Slayer Loli. So...
What the fuck am I reading? It's like my favorite reaction image you have.
Yeah. But anyways, yeah, she's able to bring out a lot of warmth and gentleness to the character. And when Wendy does have her moments of badassery, especially here in this movie.
Dragon Force Wendy.
Dragon Force Wendy, yes. And human Carla. Magical girl Carla, to be more specific.
Oh, yeah. My favorite thing was in the movie theater when that happened and everybody in her group was like, the fuck?
Because nobody understood, because I hadn't seen that far in the show, and I'm like, what the fuck just happened?
But anyways, yeah, I think Brittany plays Wendy rather well, and like I said, just with David Walden Goggins, it's become very iconic to her character as a point. Jade Saxon as Carla. This is the most unique role I think Jade has ever played, because she has a rather decent range, but there have been characters who sound very similar. Like, you could tell, hey, that's Jade Saxton. Carla is different because no other character she plays has ever sounded like Carla. And I think that's one of the good things, is that she can point to this specific tone of voice and say it belongs to this character. If you hear her voice as Carla, you can say no other character sounds quite like that. And I have to commend Jade for that, because she brings the sort of, you know, sassy nanny, very, you know...
Fran Drescher.
Fran... Not that much, no.
God damn.
Wendy, what are you doing?
Never do that again.
No, I want you to do one thing in that voice.
What?
Oh, do Ichiya's man in the Fran Drescher voice.
Man.
That sounds like a goddamn
goat. Hardy has finally hit his true form.
Man. but yeah, I like these two, and they play off each other very well, and they're just so adorable together. So they're the heart of the crew.
Oh boy. What to say about Wendy and Carla as I hold Carla fleshy in my hands. I kind of have to agree with what you were saying about Brittany as Wendy and how Wendy is kind of the heart of the guild, only to a certain extent, because arguably you could probably also say Natsu, because he's such a hothead, and just his don't give up attitude also kind of influences things a lot. But Wendy definitely has... Wendy's a child. Fucking child. And Brittany brings about a very strong childlike quality to her, where she has a lot of innocence to her, but she does kind of understand some things here and there. For example, in the beginning, when Lucy and Natsu are talking and they just end up getting very close together in the faces, and Wendy comes and she's like, oh my god, you were having a moment, I'm sorry. And Lucy's like, no, we weren't. So she may be a child, but she at least understands some things. But Brittany does have a very childlike quality to her, and I enjoy it a lot. Though, at first when I watched the show, it took me a bit of time to adjust to it, because unfortunately it was one of those situations where I wasn't accustomed to that kind of character from Brittany, and I wasn't a huge fan of Wendy at first, but I enjoy it a lot more now than I did back then. And as for Carla, Jade's portrayal of Carla is very interesting in terms of not just voice, but personality and her dynamic with all the other characters, specifically though, if we're talking between her and Happy. where if you put these two characters side by side, Happy and Carla, Happy's a lovable doof. Carla, she has a lot of dignity to her. Like, she's very proper and she's very intelligent, and a lot of dignity to her that I've really enjoyed Jade portraying with the character. And she's also such a very good mentor for Wendy and also a very good guide. Because the Exceeds, that's what they are, essentially, for the Dragon Slayers, is they are these guides to them and try to help them through all this stuff. And Carla does a hell of a better job than Happy ever could, for damn sure. And I really also enjoy Jade as Carla. She's one of my favorite characters from the franchise as well. Hence the Carla plushie would also be, but also be because if the three OGs were any of these Exceeds, I would probably most likely be Carla.
did anyone else notice? I'm sorry to interrupt you, but anyone else notice that when she transforms into Magical Girl Carla, the voice slightly changes?
Yes, it does.
It does. It mm-hmm. does. It does change slightly, and I do enjoy that a lot, because it makes it, it's a slight change, but it makes it distinguishable between these two forms that Carla has. So I do enjoy that a lot. But I do like both these performances. I do.
Megan?
No. Oh, God. Sorry. While you were talking, Andrew sent me really funny My Hero art of Todoroki frying an egg on himself.
I think I've seen that one.
Nice.
No, it's one with all the Todoroki siblings, because Todoroki has, like, three older siblings, and it's, like, I guess, like, a happy universe where their dad wasn't a total dick and tore them apart. And it's, like, the sister's nice. Like, Mom's out with friends right now. What do you want for dinner? Oh, you guys are animals. And there's just, like, bacon on two of them, and just, like, Todoroki's covered in, like, bacon and fried eggs. I'll send it to the OG chat, because it's adorable as sin.
That's great.
Just Todoroki's face is just fucking hilarious. So I sent it to my other friends, and my friend Haku, whose birthday was yesterday, said, Lord knows if I had heat powers, that's exactly how I would have used them.
Yeah.
It's just making bacon on myself.
Yeah, it's like, you kind of wanted to put together sort of a My Hero equivalent of Jackass, where all the kids just do stupid stuff.
Yeah, they just do stupid shit. And, like, one of them is, like, I think that's one of them, too. It's, like, they're all freaking out as Todoroki, like, fries an egg on himself.
Yeah.
It's, like, the only thing that's better than that was the conversation one night between Hazu and Sarah that Sarah put up on Twitter, where Hazu asked if Ida would top or bottom, and her response would Ida would say, that's against school regulations. And you know it's not wrong. You know that's not wrong. That's how we'd answer.
Mm-hmm. Wow.
And you know that's also how Carla would answer. Because it's against Magic Guild registration. No, Brittany Karbowski is just adorable Brittany Karbowski in this. And I actually bring this up in the Monster Musume episode. Is that I can't ever actually hear Brittany Karbowski be in, like, fan service-y shows as, like, the Lolly character. Because I keep going back and hearing Wendy.
It sort of tainted you for life.
Yeah.
Monster Musume was awful for me because of...
Yeah, Mom Musume for her was a horrendous time.
So, no, but Brittany Karbowski just... it like, Wendy... Hearing how confident Wendy is in Dragon Cry,
mm-hmm.
As opposed to when she first started and was very much kind of a crybaby, it was really great. And seeing her use Dragon Force was badass as fuck. So no, I've come to enjoy really Brittany Karbowski in this. I do want to go back and try to finish Fairy Tales anime just so I can say I could. So I just don't really have much to say on that. Carla is like my favorite female character in all of Fairy Tale. And a lot of people rag on her because she's kind of this bitchy Mary Poppins, but, like, she's Mom-chan. She's Wendy's Mom-chan.
She is Mom-chan. She's also very, very competent.
But you guys are totally right. Like, no other Jade Saxton character sounds like Wendy like Carla. Like,
mm-hmm.
It's the almost exact opposite of Brittany Karbowski as Wendy, where
right.
A lot of little girls, like, for me, I associate that with Brittany Karbowski's Wendy voice, but nothing else Jade Saxton does sounds like Carla, and that's really cool, especially with how much anime Jade Saxton's in. So I enjoy this. I enjoyed her performance in this, getting to kind of like sass people and also becoming a magical girl and getting like a slightly like haughty Dare Dare voice for her magical girl form, if you know what a Dare Dare is. So, but I'm good to move on. Are we good to move on?
Yes, please.
Yeah.
Fuck this section. let's talk about my two least favorite characters and actually my favorite member of the Natsu team at once. Urza Scarlet, Gray Fullbuster, and Juvia Lockstar.
Oh, God.
Here we go. Hope your Gradar is ready.
Damn it.
She saw his penis.
That's a penis.
It's true. Yeah, fuck you. Fuck you. Fuck you, A1 Studios. You let us see Lucy's ass crack, but you won't let us see Gray's, you bastards. Give us ladies Gray service.
God damn it. We get enough as is with him stripping all the fucking
time. I want to see Gray's dick.
His little icicle.
I want to see his ice pick.
Can we move
no.
on?
No. Because Urza Scarlet is played by Colleen Quickenbeard, Gray Fullbuster is played by Newton Pittman, and Juvia Lockstar is played by Brina Palencia. Colleen Quickenbeard, you will know as Momo Yazarozu in My Hero Academia, Titania in The Ancient Magus Bride, ha 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 ha, and Ashramaru in Seraph of the End. Newton Pittman, you will know as Vano Clemente, got fucking screwed in 91 Days. Zwei in Phantom Requiem for the Phantom, and Ryu Yamada in Yamada and the Seven Witches. Brita Palencia, you'll know as Ennis in Baccano, I, Enma in Hellgirl, and Juliet in Romeo x Juliet.
Did you just turn into Finico for a second there?
Stop it!
Hardy, are you okay?
Yeah, I'm all right.
Do you want me to turn into Ferritco?
No. No, please don't. Or else I'll do the man voice again.
No, I'm sorry. Behave. Okay. I'll behave. Hardy, go ahead.
All right. Not much to say. I think I'm being a broken record again that as far as Urza goes, this is the voice that you associate. This is the character you associate with Colleen more than pretty much... At this point, pretty much any other character I can think of, because she is rather iconic as Urza. The problem I have with it is this: she uses her Urza voice for several other characters. And that's why I love Colleen as an actress, but I'm kind of hesitant to want to hear her in certain roles because I feel like we're just going to be hearing Urza Scarlet again. But I mean, she plays Urza very well. I mean, she is, I can't think of anyone else I would have cast her as, but you know, that's just my one critique is that she's so iconic as Urza. Now you go into this other character. Oh, hey, it's Urza. I'm getting off track here, but I mean, Colleen is basically Urza at this point, and she always will be. I wouldn't cast her as anyone else. Newton Pittman doesn't really do a whole lot of voice acting. I think mainly because he's a registered nurse, and this is sort of a...
Hell yeah!
Yeah, this is just sort of his second
side job,
yeah. But he's very good as Gray. Could add a little bit more emphasis, I guess is the word more. But I mean, he, once again, you know, the voice is iconic to this character. Like, you hear Newton Pittman in pretty much anything, and so, hey, it's Gray Fullbuster. Which I will give him some credit. I was very impressed by his role as Twice in My Hero Academia, because he got to play something drastically different than what he usually does. He was basically anime Deadpool, and I was really, really impressed with that. And the one standout for me here is Brina as Juvia, because some people really hate this character, and I completely understand why. But
she's so fucking wasted.
Yeah. I actually like Juvia, to be honest, and I like how...
I'll explain why I don't like her when we get to it.
Right.
When I talk.
Yeah. I know she has lots of problems, and she probably needs to go see a shrink, but I do admit that I enjoy Juvia as a character. Obviously, she is gray focused. She likes gray a whole lot. Let's just put it that
she
way.
She is gray sexual.
She is gray sexual, yes. And I like how when Brina gets to really ham her up when she either feels threatened that someone's taking Gray away from her, or she gets lovey-dovey, and her scene at the beginning where she imagines that she's sort of seducing all the people, including Levy and Panther Lily.
Yep. Yeah.
I can't believe Juvia Lockstar is a bisexual furry.
But
confirmed.
But the moment that I most enjoyed from her performance in this film, and I think you could probably guess it, is when Juvia effectively turns into Yuno.
Oh, God.
From Future Diary.
Oh, God.
Oh, yeah, because of two dolls.
She is knocked nearly unconscious, and in her daze, she hallucinates that these two small dolls are actually two pretty women coming after Gray, and she goes full yandere and turn. And from that moment, it was just Brina playing Yuno all over again. And she does the little heart-shaped water attack and everything.
And nearly destroys a building.
Yep.
But anyways, yeah, I mean, that's all I have to say at this point. I am more critical of these performances, but I think they are so iconic to these characters, I would not cast anyone else to play them. So.
Okay. Where do I even start? I have a confession to make. I'm not the biggest fan of Yuno Gasai.
No, really, tell us more.
I'm also not the biggest fan of Brina Palencia playing Yuno Gasai. This is also speaking of watching the show like 3-4 years ago. Side note. So her Juvia, it wasn't just the one scene where she completely snaps as a yandere. It was a good amount of the performance in the film itself that reminded me a lot of, you know? Like, because Juvia is very, very obsessive. Like, she's very obsessive over Gray, but the big thing with Juvia, and thankfully this sets Juvia apart from, you know, is that Juvia has a lot of energy and pep to her. It's not a darker yandere. It's just...
It's played for laughs.
It's played for laughs, which kind of saves it a bit, because I'm not a fan of, you know. But the full-fledged yandere part where she destroys the fucking dolls is great. But Brina as Juvia has always been... Juvia, unfortunately, I feel like... in the franchise, and kind of in the movie it shows us too, she ends up being the butt of the joke part of the time, which Juvia is more than that, and it's kind of disappointing that the franchise turned her into a joke at points, but it's still a lot of fun. Like, she definitely has a lot of energy, she's very obsessive, yes, but she does have a lot of sincerity to her, and Brina does portray that very well. As for Urza and Colleen, Colleen's Urza is probably one of the more mature female characters in the show. And one that shows or portrays a lot of strength to her. But you do see also that Urza, this is realized in the film at least, despite her being a strong person, she does have a softness to her. She does have a girly side to her. And she's also very mature. And Colleen... There's a lot of personality traits to Urza. And Colleen just portrays all this flawlessly to me. And as for Newton Pittman as Gray, he's an interesting one. Because like you were saying, we almost never see him in anime. It's one of those rare things. And of course, this is one of those situations that because of that... When anyone talks about Newton Pittman, you're going to immediately talk about Gray. Like, right off the bat. And, because this is the most iconic role that he's ever done. And, Gray is such a goober. Such a goddamn goober. Because, with Gray, he... he's very snarky and he has this confidence to him. I don't want to say this suave swagger to him, because that's not the right way to put it. And he's also not cocky. He has this air of confidence to him, and he's very, very snarky and combative with Natsu in particular. And as a balance, basically as a balance between him, Natsu, and Erza, it's a fun dynamic and a fun interaction between those three in particular. And any time Gray all of a sudden magically appears in just his boxers is the most hilarious thing in the world. Because he's like, wait, when did that happen? Like, are you fucking serious? No, when they first took the Dragon Cry, they're running through the streets of the kingdom of Stella, and when Gray is getting involved, he's approaching these guards to attack them. While he's doing that, he's stripping off his fucking clothes.
No, his clothes are getting shot off by arrows.
Fuck that's yeah, like, bitch.
Something like that. And then later on, when they're all sitting at the campfire, and he's like, oh, it's so cold up here. And then Natsu's like, well, why don't you put on some damn clothes? And he's like, wait, when did that happen? Like, it's like hours later. It's like, you're stupid. And it's wonderful. And
Gray is the best member of Team Natsu. Fight me.
Gray is the best member of Team Natsu. Fight me. But he's a joy to watch, and I enjoy Newton Pittman a lot. I enjoy all three of these, but of course Newton Pittman is Gray is probably my favorite.
Oh god, let's get Gray out of the way, because I have a lot to say about the other two, because I actually, they're like two of my least favorite anime characters ever. Like, I do not like them.
Oh boy.
I love Newton Pittman as Gray. I wish Newton Pittman was in more anime.
Same.
But he has an actual cool real life job as, well, okay, that's sweet to say. Newton Pittman has a really cool job that isn't voice acting, which is being a registered fucking nurse, and that's metal as hell to me. That this man one day could take care of a kid and just do the Gray voice and make the kid feel better. And that would be baller as fuck.
Oh god.
And I love him as Gray, because Gray to me has to kind of have a chill tone to his voice, because if I yes. feel like if he put too much into it, he becomes kind of as obnoxious as Natsu is.
Yeah.
And
that's why I was saying earlier, that dynamic is very, very good.
And like
important.
If it's, and I will admit this is iconic for him, because yeah, this is like the first thing I think of when you talk about Newton Pittman. It's like, right. Oh, he's Gray in Fairy Tail. Like, I'm not finished with 91 Days. I'm still fucking pissed at what happened to his character. Fuck you, Austin Tindall.
You're gonna be mad at about it.
Oh yeah.
I haven't even gotten to the goddamn lasagna scene yet.
No, not that.
Everyone keeps telling me to brace myself for lasagna. Pasta.
Well, there's you do have to brace yourself for lasagna, but there's other stuff.
Oh, I already know that Corneo loses his goddamn Skittles.
No, not that.
Anyway, but no, like, I love Newton Pittman. I loved him in this movie. Like, I love how doofy Gray is at times, and how he never, like, there's an aspect of the way that he plays Gray, where Gray never is not taking himself 100% serious.
True.
Like,
true facts.
Gray is always playing, like, he always plays Gray, that Gray is 100% serious about what he's fucking doing, regardless of the circumstance, unless Juvia is around. To which, Brita Palencia makes Juvia likable to me. Because without Brita's energy and the way that she understands this character, Juvia is borderline unlikable as fuck. Like, Juvia has really cool aspects to her character. Like, she fought, like, I think it's when Loxus is being a supreme butthole.
When is he not being a supreme butthole? That's the thing.
After Tenro Island.
Oh, yeah.
True facts.
When he takes over the town for the festival.
Right.
Juvia gives up herself to break free of Freed's thing, I think. I think, yeah, she sacrifices herself because she likes everybody. But for
right.
some reason, the fucking...
That's right, it was Juvia and Kana, right?
Specifically, Juvia does it so Kana can go ahead.
Right.
And like on Tenro Island, when Merity connects herself, she walks Merity out of killing Gray. But the show thinks it's fun, and like the series thinks it's fun to be like, hey, Juvia should just be a yandere for Gray all the time. And it pisses me the fuck off. Like, I hate the fact that Juvia is the butt of a joke when she's a really cool character in concept. Also, B, she was powerful enough to be with it on the same level as Godgeal at one point. Like, everyone forgets that. But
yeah, everyone forgets that Juvia and Godgeal were
like, they were part
evil.
Of the same, like, four thing. And, like, everyone forgets that because the second Juvia saw Gray and started getting wet for him, like, her personality just, like, kind of fucking disappears. Unless, like, they're like, oh yeah, Juvia's strong, we have to remember that. But Brina Palencia puts a lot of heart into the performance and a lot of nuance. Even when Juvia is being, like, a crazy yandere, and hey, Brina Palencia is really good at playing crazy yandere, so it's an iconic performance for her, and if she needs to be associated with any yandere, I'd rather her be associated with Juvia over Yuno. And, oh.
True facts.
Oh god, Colleen is Urza. Colleen plays Urza fine. I do agree with Hardy that sometimes, like, I don't have the same issue that Hardy does where I hear Urza and everything because I didn't watch Fairy Tail until I watched a lot of other things that Colleen's in. I just don't like this character because, no offense, I think Urza's a Mary Sue.
She is very much a Mary Sue, yeah.
She's a Mary Sue.
She very much
She's a Mary Sue. I'm sorry. Like, and the other thing that they do with her is they also, like, infantilize her trauma because Urza's been through some shit and the show likes to make jokes about it at times and I'm just like, please stop. Like,
yeah.
Like, hey, Fairy Tail, can you stop treating your female characters like absolute garbage sometimes? But Colleen doesn't.
Go ahead.
What?
Go ahead.
No, go ahead. You first.
Well, here's the thing is that Urza sort of has been championed by the fan base as the strong female character because she actually wins all of her fights. And so, while that is admirable, unfortunately, she seems to be the only female character who wins all of her fights. All the others, especially when we get to Lucy, because good.
Poor fucking Lucy. Here's the thing. By the way, making Urza win every fight doesn't make her a strong female character. It makes her badly written.
Mm-hmm.
Very true.
But Colleen doesn't... we're not here to talk about the writing, but Colleen does a really good job making Urza palatable. For me, Urza's a character, like, in the Japanese, I don't think I would like the performance, because I don't like the character, and Colleen makes listening to her a lot easier, and I will admit, Colleen does a really good job, the first time what the fuck is Tattoo Face's name?
Jalal.
I'm Jalal, he's Jalal! That
oh, oh yeah!
He's Jalal! Is anybody else in here Jalal? I'm leaving.
I'm Jalal!
Oh. I'm Jalalicus! I'm Spartacus, but it's Jalal. The arc that with Jalal and that shit where it goes over her backstory, that was the peak of Urza's fucking character. fight me. And Kali played that really well, but she also did a really good job in the movie. It even felt like even in the movie, Urza didn't do that much besides do, like, one cool fight and that's it.
Pretty much, yeah.
Oh, that and just be in, like, a skin-tight bunny outfit where, like, a camera lingers way too long in her crotch and underboob. So with that being said, time to move on to the final group.
Yep.
Woo!
That is Natsu Dragneel, the fire dragon slayer slash hero of our story slash will also always win a fight unless they need him to lose once so he can learn, like, the meaning of friendship and come back. Fuck, I actually blanked on Lucy's full name. Lucy Hartphelia, the heroine of our story and actually kind of supposedly the main character?
Kinda, sorta.
She's supposed to be.
And Happy, Natsu's exceed best friend and obnoxious little shitlord.
True facts.
He's not the worst exceed.
He's not.
Because the worst exceed is Lecter. We can all agree that Lecter is the worst.
I cannot agree with that because I haven't gotten that far.
You've never met... Oh, that's right. You haven't met Sting's exceed. He's awful. Natsu Dragneel is played by Todd Haberkorn. Lucy is played by Jeremy Lee, and Happy is played by Tia Ballard. Todd fucking Habercorn, you will know as Lindell in The Ancient Magus Bride, Ayatoki Hiroshima in Tokyo Ghoul, and Masao in Shiki. Jeremy Lee, you will know as Tamaki Kawazoe in Bamboo Blade, Shunpei in Oedo Rocket, and Tsuniko Kiyotoshiki in Shiki. Tia Ballard, you will know as 02 in Darling in the Franxx, Megumi Shimizu in Shiki, and Aligula in Blood Blockade Battlefront.
A lot of Shiki.
Shiki's a good anime. It's a shame it's out of print.
This pleases me.
Also, B, I kind of did Todd and Tia off the top of my head without looking at an A&N article.
Wow.
And those weren't all the ones that popped into my head first.
Way to go.
I also did Colleen without looking at an A&N article.
All right, so here's our main trio. And what is there really to be said that hasn't already been said? I think in all three cases, with maybe the exception of Tia now that Darling in the Franxx is out, these are the characters you think of when you hear these voices. And it has pretty much propelled all of them into voice acting, I would say voice acting superstardom as far as anime is concerned. Because when you hear Todd Habercorn, you think of Natsu. When you hear Jeremy Lee, a lot of people will think of Lucy. Of course, she, you know, there are other characters you can associate with.
That hussy Asuna.
Yeah. And just, yeah, it's fairy tale dub in general. It's very, very iconic. And I think all three of these performances fit these characters like a glove. I do not think, honestly, I could have cast anyone else in these performances. That's really all I have to say. Aye, sir.
Aye, sir.
Aye, sir.
Aye, sir.
Aye, sir. Okay.
Nya, hearty son. Nya.
Oh, God. All right. So, speaking of Happy, Happy's a fun and interesting character. Because as we all recall and remember, years ago, I was not the biggest fan of Tia Ballard, and I learned my fucking lesson. Mostly through Kami-sama Kiss. But having her here as Happy is a lot of fun. Because Happy's the most adorable, dumb little X-seed in the entire world.
He's just so happy.
He's... Damn it. He's so happy, and he's so stupid, and he has a lot of earnesty and sincerity to him, and Tia just portrays all of that wonderfully. Jeremy as Lucy. Lucy has a lot of spunk to her, too. Not, like, a peppy kind of energy. She has a lot of spunk. She also has a lot of heart to her. She's also a goddamn damsel in distress half the fucking time.
This poor girl gets screwed out of so much.
It's kind of disappointing, but that's how the franchise has written her at this fucking point. But, she is supposed to be the character that you kind of self-insert yourself into. Because you kind of see her grow and you feel like you're growing along with her and with the show and in this film. Minus the sex dungeon.
That's like not even the first time Lucy's been almost put in a sex dungeon in this franchise.
Anyway, I really do enjoy Jeremy, and this is definitely one of those iconic roles for her, whatever you think of Jeremy. Though, if we really want to talk about iconic, we gotta talk about Todd Habercorn here as Natsu. I'm gonna steal some words that Hardy has sometimes said before. I don't think Todd Habercorn plays Natsu. I think he is Natsu.
Really?
I mean, the man does, like, have the tattoo.
He does, yeah.
He does. Like, such high energy and such... Like, it's equal parts energetic, hot-headed, and yet very heartfelt. Like I was saying, I know Hardy was saying that Wendy seems to be the heart of the guild. I also kind of think that so is Natsu, because he has this never give up attitude, is all shonen protagonists tend to have. But point is, he has a lot of heart and a lot of energy to him, and a lot of and such stupid obliviousness. And there's a lot of qualities to Natsu's character, and Todd just encapsulates all of them to the point where, like I said, I don't feel like Todd is playing Natsu, that he is Natsu. And obviously, whenever you think of Todd Haberkorn, the first role that's probably going to come up to everyone's minds is going to be Natsu. Like, this is what Todd is known for. This right here. This is his most iconic role, bar none. And honestly, with good reason. He, with all the energy and the personality that Natsu has and how Todd portrays it, it's a lot of fun. Can Natsu be grating sometimes on the ears? Absolutely. But Natsu is also obnoxious as fuck sometimes.
At least he's not Asta.
Exactly. Though,
true
again,
to
be fair, Dallas Reed still makes him more tolerable. Good on you, sir. But yeah, if anything, I'm firmly of the belief that Todd is Natsu. With all the wacky, fun, energetic, and hot-headed and heartfelt personality all mixed in. So I do enjoy all three of these characters.
So I have to say this. I have to bring it back because it's iconic for us.
Mm-hmm. All right. I'm waiting to go for it.
Are you happy?
Absolutely.
Nyah, Stephanie saw. Nyah.
Shut the fuck up. You ruined the moment.
We can never make that joke on this show ever again.
It was a long time coming for me to actually not argue with that joke. You ruined it. Damn it.
You know, like, yeah.
Shut the fuck up.
Never. Sorry, go. If you want to redo your moment, I'm sorry for ruining it.
No, it's fine.
No, it's good now.
No, I feel bad.
It's fine. Makes for fun banter. Go ahead.
So is it weird that I actually don't, like... These are not my favorite performances from Todd or Tia. Like, they're iconic to them.
I mean, to be fair, sure.
They're iconic to them, and I understand why, but these are probably not two of my favorite performances. I do, however, think it's a shame now that Happy is no longer Tia's most iconic character.
Meh.
My feelings for that show aside, even I can agree that. Look, I'll put it out there. Guys, I hate Darling in the Franxx. I love the dub. It's really good.
Yay! I gotta finish it. There's one episode for me to watch.
Such a train wreck! But no, I have to agree with everything that they've said. This is not the... These are not the roles that I came to know these people through. Mm. Like I said, I actually didn't actively start watching Fairy Tail until, like, last year. So I got to know Tia through, like, a bunch of other different things. And that's just really weird now. I actually don't know what the first show I watched Tia Ballard in or Todd is. Oh god, this is actually... What the fuck?
Well, I know the first Tia show that I recognize her for, and we all know what happened there.
Oh shit.
Her name is Megumi.
Fuck, this is gonna bother me. I think, honest to god, I think the first show that I really knew Todd in was, like, Italia. As Italy.
I think for me it was Oron.
Yeah, that would be it by the one. And like
For me it was My Bride is a Mermaid.
I don't even know
Todd was definitely Oron for me, and then Jeremy was Soul Eater.
That would be the big one that I kind of knew them all from is Soul Eater.
Yeah.
Because I think Tia is somebody in Soul Eater too. I
don't remember her being in there.
I don't remember, but anyway.
While you're talking, I shall resolve this.
I don't have a lot to add on because you guys have kind of said everything for me. I really do want to talk about, like, I love Jeremy as Lucy. Like, it's also up there as one of my favorite performances in the show. And, like, I actually really like Lucy as a character. I just hate the way that they, like, do her dirty.
Right.
Like, they do her dirty a lot. And, I think that the show really made me appreciate them all as actors and actresses. And without this dub, I don't think that we would have our expectations of their acting the way that we do. And I feel really weird because I don't know what to say. Like, I honest to god don't have any words for this. Like, it's really good. You should watch it. Fairy's Tales dub is really solid, and Natsu, Todd, Jeremy, and Tia as a core of the show really hold it together. They are the rock and foundation of the show. Like,
yeah.
Without, if you, I don't think you could put them in anywhere else and have the show be as good as it is. So,
side note before you transition, because I feel like you're about to transition. Tia was not in Soul Eater.
Then what the fuck would I have watched her in?
Kami-sama Kiss, maybe?
No, actually, yeah. Yeah, that would be
because I know for me after she, Shiki, Kami-sama Kiss really turned my opinion like 180 on her.
Well, no, because I started getting more back into dubs because of a video you made about Kami-sama Kiss, about, like, actors.
Oh.
And I watched Kami-sama Kiss, and then, like, holy shit. Anyway, go ahead. Final thoughts.
I think we've already had our final thoughts. The movie itself is very hit or miss. There's a lot of plot holes. There's a lot of just
fan service.
A lot of fan service. A lot of just dumb stuff. It's fun time with friends. That's yes. What and absolutely. What makes it so iconic for us especially is this is the first thing we ever did when we met for the first time in real life. And
yeah,
that's what makes it so precious to us is because it will for this movie, as bad as it is, or as good as it is, you know, with all its warts.
Or underwhelming. Yeah.
For all its warts, we will always have this memory. And that will always be important to precious to us, yeah. And so...
Mm-hmm. Yeah, as much as I've been kind of dunking on Fairy Tail as a franchise, like, Fairy Tail also has a lot of things I really enjoy about it. Like, Fairy Tail is one of the only shows that has ever had me actively fucking hate a character and turn them around on it. I there is Twitter proof that I said I will never like Gajio as a character.
There is.
Yeah, I remember that.
And I was wrong. And it also has a dub that really, if the dub of this show did not exist in the form that it did, I don't think we would have a lot of the actors that we really know and love today around. Like, if Dragon Ball Z and Yu Yu Hakusho set the base, and FMA set the base, like, for the early, the 90s and early 2000s of Funimation, I think Fairy Tail really cemented the early 2010s, like how My Hero is really cementing, like, the late 2010s.
I would say probably Fairy Tail, and I would actually probably put Soul Eater in that category, to be honest.
And One Piece.
And One Piece. Well, everyone in their mom is in fucking One Piece.
Yeah.
I'm pretty sure one day we're going to walk in there and be like, hey, we need people to do Foley acting. Will you guys be in One Piece?
Why, sure.
Okay, while we're here.
I'll let Luffy punch me. But, like, in all seriousness, though, like, I dunk on Fairy Tail a lot, but I still enjoy Fairy Tail as a shonen series. Like, it's not the worst thing. Like, it's not fucking Bleach.
No.
It's not fucking later Naruto.
No, I mean, for me, it is a fun show, and the film itself is, like I was saying before, it doesn't feel like a separate standalone. It doesn't feel like a separate entity entirely, though it can work to some people as a standalone, so long as you have, like, basic knowledge of the lore in the universe. But it feels like it's completely part of the whole story. There's no, it doesn't feel any different or anything. And one of the things, the big shonen tropes is the power of friendship. And the power of friendship sure is strong with this movie when we watched it together last year.
Damn straight.
And
the boys will be reenacting it this year.
Pretty much.
With a much better movie.
Yes. But to be fair, like, it's definitely, like Cardi was saying, it's a very good fun time with friends. So, because when I watched it by myself yesterday, I'm like, I was like, Megan, I was similar to Megan's thoughts when she watched it earlier. I'm like, it's not as enjoyable as I remember it. And it's because we were watching it all together, and that was what was the most enjoyable about it. So, if anything, definitely watch Fairy Tale with your Fairy Tale Dragon Cry with your friends. And the dub is...
Just watch Fairy Tale with your friends.
Yes. And the dub of it is so much fun. It really is. Despite some of the minor gripes I know I have here and there with it, it's a lot of fun. Definitely cemented a lot of voice actors that to, like, infamous mainstream status at this point. And it's a great time, so you'll have a great time. Just go watch it with friends, though, because that just makes it even better.
If you want to watch Fairy Tale Dragon Cry, you will have to buy it.
Yep.
It is not, unfortunately, is not streaming on Funimation now or Crunchyroll. However, you can buy it physically from Funimation. I believe you can also buy it digitally through Amazon Prime Video. Or if you're like me,
it's available through the regular retailer.
Yeah, through your regular retailer. Or if you're like me and you have somebody who did buy it, you can use the Funimation digital code and use that.
Like me.
However, if you want to watch Fairy Tail proper, the anime, you can watch the sub over on Crunchyroll, and you can watch the dub on Funimation, including its prequel Fairy Tail Zero. With that being said, that is Spaceman Hardy. You can. You know what? We have enough time. Whore yourselves out. Put that leggy out.
I sneeze. I'm sorry.
I'm Spaceman.
Put your leggy out.
I'm Spaceman Hardy. You can find me on Twitter at Spaceman Hardy. I don't post as many goats as I need to, but I'm also a moderator over at the Funimation Forum and Discord.
My name is Stephanie. You can follow me on Twitter at Lilac Anime Review, with review being spelled R-E-V-U-E, because Hardy is so creative like that and helped me with the fucking name.
Well, now it works. Starlight Review is a thing.
Well, the reason why it's spelled that way...
I know what it is. I'm making a joke.
No. The only reason why I picked it that way is because the other way you spell review, it wouldn't fit for fucking characters at the time. Anyway. Yeah, you can follow me on Twitter. I pretty much post about daily life and the struggles and how the struggle is real. And, like, for example, at the time of recording this earlier today, how I was doing homework for my dance class while I was at work because it was kind of quiet and dead. things like that. Mundane, silly little things like that. And I also don't really do much else special, so...
I'm Megan. You can follow me at QueenR2, where I post about sword boys, cry, shit post, flirt with my boyfriend, Roots of Justice. And I also hang out on the Funimation Discord and forums. With that being said, we thank you all for listening to this mess of an episode.
well, another OG night in the bag.
So, get your beer, party hard like Kana, don't destroy things like guild arts, and otaku on, my friends. I'm doing the little fairy tale pose in my room by myself, and nobody can see it but me.
I'm holding Carla. I have my Carla plushie. We're good. Bye, everyone. Have a good night.